Hi, everybody.
My name is Nicola Morizzi. I'm a cardiologist from Lausanne University Hospital in Switzerland and very passionate about cardiomyopathies. And I'd like to welcome you to the third HCM Pills episode. I'm very happy to be here with Professor Perry Elliott, a true pioneer in the field, a world-leading expert, and we'll be very happy today to provoke you on some discussion about sudden cardiac death, which is unfortunately a part of the disease of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and about cardiomyopathy in general. I'd just like to remember that this series of podcasts is supported by the European HCM Association, a non-profit HCM organization that aims in improving the understanding of this disease towards patients all over Europe. So Perry, let's go to the heart of the problem. What is sudden cardiac death?
Yeah, it's a really good question because I think patients often misunderstand the terminology. So what we mean is an unexpected death of a patient within a very small time frame. So yeah, all death is ultimately sudden in one respect, but if it occurs in the context of someone who's got severe heart failure, they're hospitalized, we wouldn't regard that as being sudden. But if that individual has been well, or indeed if the death occurs during night when they're asleep with no antecedent symptoms, we regard that as being a sudden death. I think in conversations with patients, sometimes that term is conflated with heart attack. So we often ask about family history. Has anybody in the family died suddenly? Oh, well, my uncle had a heart attack. What do they mean by that? Sometimes it means a genuine sudden death. Sometimes it means what we mean by a heart attack, which is a blocked coronary artery leading to myocardial infarction. But I think in the conversation, it's very important to be clear. We're talking about a sudden, unexpected ventricular arrhythmia, which leads ultimately to the death of the patient if not treated.
Very clear and very important, I believe. So how rare is sudden cardiac death in HCM?
So it's interesting, isn't it? I think if any patient who's given the diagnosis of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, when they leave the doctor's clinic and they go home and they go onto the internet and they have what I call a Google moment, because you see sudden death, young people, young footballer dies. The reputation of the disease is one which is strongly affected by the problem of sudden death. In reality, it's a rare problem now. So if you look at large populations, it's probably less than 1% per year, probably almost down to 0.5% per year. And that's if you include people that are getting shocks from devices. So the absolute rate is low. And I think that's a really important message when we see people for the first time. Say, look, most people with this disease are at low risk. Our job is to identify that small group of people who are at increased risk because we can protect them.
So you mentioned a very important part of our job, a very, you know, fearing complication about this disease. You said devices. So how do you identify those people who are more at risk and how do you protect them?
So the approach is a systematic one. So we look for features of the disease that we know from studies published over many, many years associate with an increased risk of dying suddenly. As I often say, there's nothing magic about these things. They're just telling you how bad the heart is. So, for example, how thick the muscle is, whether you have rhythms that can be detected on a tape, whether there's a bad family history, which is, if you like, a surrogate for the underlying genetic abnormality. What we've done in recent years is to take that information and try to put that into a tool which allows us to create a number that we can then talk around with patients. So based now on probably more than 8,000 people with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, we have a risk score which says, okay, based on your characteristics, in the next 5 years, the chances of something happening is maybe 1% or 2% or 5%. Although I rarely put it in those terms. What I say is if I take 100 people like you, in the next 5 years, five of them may have an event. Let's talk about that. Is that a high risk to you? Is that a risk that you find acceptable? Because, of course, there's no such thing as a definition of acceptable risk. Your acceptance of risk may be different to mine, may be different to the patient. And, of course, it changes through life. So if you're a 16-year-old, you're immortal, you know, your priorities in life are very different. So you may accept a relatively high risk. If you see that 16-year-old again in, say, 10 years' time or 15 years' time, when he's now married, he has his first child, Well, maybe, yeah, I'm not prepared to accept that level of risk anymore. If you're 80, my main problem is maybe quality of life.
Yeah.
So that's why the number is so useful. It gives you an anchor in the conversation about, yeah, is this an acceptable risk to you? If we reach the point of consensus between us that it's not, we have a very powerful tool to protect people, which is the implantable defibrillator. And the evidence would suggest, although we have no randomized trials, the evidence would suggest that it is certainly protective and prevents most episodes of ventricular arrhythmia should they occur. So deliberate process of risk stratification, estimation of risk, and then a decision with that individual as to whether or not, yeah, it's appropriate to put in a defibrillator.
I couldn't agree more, of course, in the systematic and scientific approach that you have to have in first instance. But then we go back to the human level,
mm-hmm.
because we are doctors, we treat patients. And of course, there is a dynamic discussion that has to go on at every visit with our patients, at every consultation. And of course, you value a lot the sort of a shared decision making.
Mm.
There is to say, I'm not imposing something to you, but let's see what's your feeling about it. Because at the end of the day, I mean, when you have to carry a defibrillator in a young person, you have to be, you know, very, very much into the project and agree with all the aspects of the project. So how important is in your practice this shared decision making right now, also with the advent of new treatments?
Mm. It's fundamental, but I think we have to be very clear what we mean by shared decision making. Because I think as physicians, what we often think shared decision making is just a conversation. Well, I talk to the patients, we share the decision. That's not shared decision making. Shared decision making means that you have to provide the individual, the patient, with the information and the tools that they need to be able to participate in that discussion. That's why, for example, the risk tool is so useful. So
it's a base.
Yeah, and it's also important for us to say what we do know and what we don't know. So we can give opinions, but the evidence we think shows that this is effective. But here, we're not sure. So this approach is followed in many other areas of medicine, for example, in oncology, for example, using sometimes visual aids to explain what risk really means. When I use the tool, I actually have my laptop open in the clinic, and I'll actually run through that. What we're trying to develop now are actual visual aids where you can graphically show what a risk of 3% looks like. How does that balance against the risks of an intervention? The lifelong risks of having intravascular leads, et cetera, et cetera. So shared decision making is a deliberate process.
It's an active process,
but it's fundamental, I think, to good management of the patient.
Couldn't agree more. So we have devices that are very effective in protecting our patients, a very acceptable complication rate over a lifetime, because most of our patients at risk are at their younger age. Mm. And what about the landscape of medication of current treatment and? And with the new advance of the new class of drug, do you think they might have if they have shown something in relation to sudden cardiac death decrease risk, or would they do it in the future?
Yeah. So we have symptomatic therapies for people who have atrial cardiomyopathy. We had for decades. So beta blockers, calcium antagonists. For people with obstruction, disopyramide, which is actually an antiarrhythmic drug with negative inotropic effects, reduces the force of contraction of the heart, which we use in people with obstruction. Those drugs can be effective in managing symptoms, but we have no evidence that the drugs that we've been using for many years have an impact on prognosis. Of course, the new game in town is a whole new class of drugs called myosin inhibitors, first of which is mavacamten. We have a second in class now, aficamten. And these drugs do two important things. They also reduce the force of contraction of the heart. So they've been shown in randomized trials, which I can't believe I'm saying in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, randomized trials. we haven't had a culture of doing that in this disease. But both drugs have been shown to reduce obstruction, improve symptoms, improve exercise tolerance. they also improve the relaxation of the heart. And we now have ongoing trials looking at people who have symptoms without obstruction. Mm-hmm. So I think we have good evidence that they are a new part of our toolbox for managing symptoms, but we don't have evidence that they improve prognosis. And that's going to be very difficult to establish. Because fortunately, the annual rate of complications in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy are so low, to be able to demonstrate a reduction in sudden death or heart failure or stroke, you've got to study thousands of people for years, ideally in a randomized trial, which is not going to happen. So maybe in 10 years' time, you know, when you're a chief of cardiology, you'll be able to look back on a retrospective study and say, look, the sudden death rates are even lower than they were when I had this discussion with this guy 10 years ago. I don't think we'll never really know whether they reduce the morbidity and mortality associated with the disease. The one footnote to that, I would say, is that we're starting to get a hint that these drugs may modify the disease. So they may possibly reduce the hypertrophy. Yeah. We can start to imagine that we might change the trajectory on which patients are, follow, maybe to heart failure, maybe to fibrosis. We'll see. So that's just a clue, is that maybe we are going to improve the overall outcome.
It comes another key question. So when is the ideal timing of starting those these treatments? So as early as possible in a pre-hypertrophy phase. So because really, if we are able to see data, and we have seen data about regression of some phenotypic clues that are extremely detrimental for the patient, the earlier the better.
I think that's a general principle in medicine. I mean, you want to treat before you develop irreversible change. I think we've seen this in other contexts, maybe in sort of, for example, inherited disorders of metabolism, where you start with patients who have the severe end of the disease, and then slowly you start to initiate the therapy earlier and earlier. At the moment, the focus is on people with symptoms. If we do demonstrate a disease-modifying effect, then the next logical trials to do would be to start treating patients who've got mild symptoms or no symptoms. On the horizon, you can say, well, what about treating people before they even develop hypertrophy? So if you take people who carry a variant that's associated with disease, well, that's the ultimate in prevention. I think we're a little way off that.
Yeah.
But it's a mindset which is starting to develop because of new drugs, the concept of gene therapy. Yeah. Why, again, wait until someone has a phenotype, get in early. But I think that's a little way off yet.
Yeah. And also our understanding probably of the transformation from having a mutation, mm-hmm. a problem in a gene, to disease is not so perfectly clear to us, because there are still individuals that do develop an extremely severe disease, whether someone else, do stay either with a mild or no disease for all their life.
So yeah, absolutely. There are several challenges with going for pre-clinical disease. One is it's younger people, often children. So doing trials in children comes with additional considerations. But you're right, if you're going to do a trial, you've got to be reasonably sure that if you're going to take people who carry a genetic variant and randomize them, are you sure that those people are going to develop disease so you can demonstrate a difference? I actually think we may already have the data,
I'm very happy to hear that.
Not just us. No, I don't miss that. I think as a community, I think we have the data, because I think one of the narratives we have in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is that genotype, phenotype, the relationship between a genetic mutation and what happens to you is very difficult to predict. I think it is for some genes, for some variants, but we've all seen families where it's like following a script. That the people are going to have the disease by their 20s or 30s or 50s. So maybe we have to be a little bit more sophisticated about looking at genotype, phenotype in relation to individual mutations. And for those that are largely predictable, start with those.
So it's very interesting from my side, my point of view, because we don't speak anymore about the disease. We don't speak anymore about a mutated gene, but we don't have to speak about single gene mutation because they do behave in a certain way. Absolutely. And predictable way. Yeah. So really this brings the concept of individualized therapy, mm-hmm. but in a healthy manner, that is to say, understanding really and knowing the disease you have. This is not only hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, this is the surname, but then there is a name, there is a sort of a date of birth, so there are many other key elements that has to be taken into account in 2024 when you deal with this disease.
I mean, yeah, the first gene was identified in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy in the late 1980s. And since then, our approach to looking at the relationship between genetic mutations and the disease has been first, well, do you have a gene mutation or not? That's the first comparison. Okay, that's helpful. Do you have a variant in one of the key genes, like beta myosin heavy chain, compared to another one of the genes? Okay, that provides you another level of information, but it's still very high level. Individual genetic mutations have very different effects on the cell, on the organ. So the issue there is you've got to have big numbers in order to be able to understand a particular variant. But again, maybe as a community, we have the data.
As a network, yeah. I could say all day discussing with Professor Elliott here, but you know, we have to close. So I thank you very much for joining us in this HCM Pill episode. And please do remember to subscribe to our channels and comment on this video to share your vision, your future questions that has to be discussed in future webcasts. So I thank you very much.